In 1984, Wes Craven's A Nightmare on Elm Street was released and went on to be the first commercial success for the independent studio, New Line Cinema. They quickly greenlit a sequel and offered it to Craven to direct, but he passed on it due to the script being what he called too ridiculous. After some time, they asked Jack Scholder to direct. Scholder was a fairly new director, with his first film being 1982's Alone in the Dark for New Line. A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge went on to be a hit, and New Line offered Scholder the job of directing Part 3. He passed on it, and Part 3 ended up going to Chuck Russell. Wanting to keep Scholder working for New Line, they offered him a sci-fi horror script called The Hidden. The script was written by Jim Cofe, who had previously written the comedy-drama Class and the sleeper hit Stakeout. It was a unique script with an alien parasite that was going on a greed-fueled rampage while passing from body to body. The story was inspired by all these tales of normal people that would suddenly go on these crime-fueled sprees with no explanation. When Cofe wrote the script, he needed a name for the FBI agent. He thought of actor Clu Gulager and decided to name the agent Gallagher. Scholder loved this script. He thought it was one of the best he'd read. It was well-written, had a good sense of humor, and moved like a roller coaster. In a way, it was like 1984's The Terminator in terms of pacing. It starts off with a bang and never stops. He thought to himself, this is the kind of movie he'd like to see, but it would be even better to see his name in front of it. New Line had high hopes for the film and gave it a $5 million budget, which would make it their most expensive film up to that point. Knowing the effects would be very important for the film, they brought in Kevin Yeager, who just worked with Scholder on A Nightmare on Elm Street 2. He was in charge of designing the parasite, which was described to him as a black membranous pulsating glob. Scholder started casting and, oddly enough, hired actor Clu Gulager, who he also worked with on Freddy's Revenge, although he was hired to play the part of Lieutenant Flynn, not Gallagher. For the role of the FBI agent Gallagher, they hired Kyle MacLachlan. MacLachlan was still a new actor at the time. He burst on the scene with the lead in David Lynch's Dune and Lynch's Blue Velvet. The director cast him because he wasn't the prototypical action star. This wasn't Arnold Schwarzenegger or Sylvester Stallone. This was an average-sized guy who could easily blend in as an FBI agent. Michael Nouri was hired to play the other lead, Officer Tom Beck. They filled out the rest of the cast with solid character actors like Edo Ross, Chris Mulkey, Clarence Felder, and William Boyette. Actress Claudia Christian got a call from her agent who said, they're recasting the role of the alien-possessed stripper. It's the only female role in the movie. It's light on dialogue, but you get to shoot machine guns. With a pitch like that, how could she say no? Christian looked into the role of stripper Brenda Lee Van Buren, and her main character attributes was that she was big-chested. The actress was tall, but wasn't at all what you would consider busty. She really wanted the part, so she stuffed her bra with socks and tissues and auditioned. They liked her and gave her an immediate callback, only this time they wanted her to wear a bikini. Knowing her previous trick wouldn't work, she inflated her chest with shoulder pads and electrical tape. Shortly after her new audition, they gave her the part. Since she had no training as a dancer, they sent her to work with Janet Jackson's choreographer to put together a dance for the film. After working with her for some time, the choreographer was frustrated with just how terrible she was at dancing and sent her to some local strip clubs to see other professionals do it. Essentially, she told her to watch them and try to mimic what they were doing. As it got closer to filming, the actress started to panic. She was nervous about stripping on film and learned part of her wardrobe was going to be a G-string made out of dollar bills. She was in great shape, but her anxiety made her think she needed to lose more weight. She went to the weight loss wellness center, the Lindora Clinic, and they placed her on a strict 500-calorie-a-day diet. The diet was called HCG, which includes getting injections of vitamins mixed with pregnant horse urine. This is to curb your hunger while getting so few calories per day. They decided they'd shoot most of the film in L.A. They needed a location where they could film the prison and police station, so they rented out the Lincoln Heights Jail. The jail was closed in 1965 and reopened in 1979 as the home of the Bilingual Foundation of the Arts. They frequently rented out the building for various productions. New Line had just used it for the boiler room scenes in A Nightmare on Elm Street. Since a later chunk of the film took place in a jail, this was the perfect location. They also took a large open section of the jail, and the production design team turned it into the police station. There were some offices in the other part of the building, which they used for studio space. As it got closer to filming, the director was making some changes to the script. Certain aspects he wanted to tweak or change to make the story flow better. In the original script, Gallagher lost his wife, but Scholder changed it to his wife and daughter. He felt that was something that would help the characters of Gallagher and Beck bond. He didn't want to do a full rewrite, he just wanted to do some polishing, as well as taking out anything that slowed the pacing down too much, as long as it didn't detract from the story. He removed some of the superfluous dialogue and tightened the opening. Originally, it opened with Detective Tom Beck going to Jack DeVries' apartment and finding an unknown guy dead. It then cut to an elaborate bank robbery sequence. He reduced it to a much quicker opening where we see the surveillance camera footage of the robbery, which goes right into a car chase. The producers agreed because they felt audiences have seen bank robberies enough in movies. The studio's big takeaway with this film was that they wanted to make it unlike any film you had seen before. They wanted it to be different. Unfortunately, the writer wasn't happy. With things in place, they started filming in early 1987. For the opening, they had a video camera recording the bank. They then pointed the film camera at the monitor to give it the surveillance appearance. The bank was a closed bank located across the street from Grauman's Chinese Theater. The alien parasite in the film was all about indulgence. It liked fast cars, violence, junk food, and loud music. Many of the excesses of the 80s. Its favorite car was a Ferrari.
I want this car.
However, Ferraris were incredibly expensive. The studio suggested using something like a Corvette. The director balked at that because he wanted this movie to stand out, and what would make it stand out more than wrecking an incredibly expensive sports car? The idea of crashing a Ferrari in the opening minutes of this film was very special. It would make people sit up and pay attention, and let them know this movie wasn't fooling around. After a long time negotiating, the studio finally agreed. The director was often asked if he really wrecked a Ferrari for the film. He said no, he didn't wreck a Ferrari. He wrecked four. He had one that was in good condition, two that were beat up so they could use them for the scenes when it crashed into things, and one that was just a shell that they blew up. Kyle MacLachlan said he played his character as if he had a mask on that hid his emotions. He tried to play it as low-key as possible, with moments where his emotions did come out. His character was one of great sorrow, which we find out over the course of the film. While the movie starts off like a cop film, it's clear, roughly 12 minutes into this, it's something else entirely. When Jack DeVries wakes up in the hospital, he then transfers the parasite to Jonathan Miller, played by William Boyette. They did this by having Kevin Yeager design two heads, one for each character. For the DeVries head, it had to have more expression, so they made it with some air bladders and controls under the skin to make it move. For the Miller one, they needed it to look as lifelike as possible, so they molded it out of latex. This made it look so real. When the actor saw it, he shouted, "Get it out of my sight! I can't look at that!" Since the head was made out of latex, it unfortunately wasn't able to withstand the heat from the lamps they used to light the film, so they had to film the sequence quickly before the mold completely melted. They said they just got the final shots they needed right as the mouth of the dummy started to rip. The record store was a real location on Melrose Avenue. Shoulder saw certain moments in the film as cathartic. Stealing, running from the cops, or beating a rude record store clerk to death. It was all the things someone might want to do, but a normal person wouldn't. The production designers were Mick and his sister CJ Strawn. Just before this, they worked on A Nightmare on Elm Street 3 for New Line. They spoke with the director and wanted to give the movie an uncomfortable feel, so they planned to have nothing blue in the film. They went out of their way to have various shades of a sickly color of green to paint the film. When Shoulder originally cast Michael Norrie, he was flabbergasted as to why the actor wasn't a big name. He was talented, good-looking, and seemed professional. As the shoot went on, he found out. Norrie and the director butted heads on numerous occasions, and Shoulder felt he was very difficult to work with. Many times, he simply refused to take the direction he was given. When Beck's daughter is looking at Gallagher, it was to show that she knew something was different. This goes along with the idea that children can see things that adults can't. She senses that he's different, but doesn't know why. There was a whole sequence where Miller takes the Ferrari and goes to the original owner's mansion, which eventually leads to him going to the storage building and finding the weapons. The director thought this whole thing just slowed the movie down, and he rewrote it so the character goes right to the storage. When Miller turns on the record player, it was originally going to play a Frank Sinatra song, which he then smashes. They couldn't afford the rights, so they just went with a random country song. For the stripper scene, they originally planned on using a Tina Turner song. They couldn't get the rights to that song either, so they used this song, Bad Girl, by Mendy Lee. Christian went to get ready for a scene and told her wardrobe assistant the truth about her lack of chest size. The mistress helped her out by designing a pair of prosthetic breasts she could wear under a cut-off t-shirt. When it came time to do the striptease, the director wasn't happy that she lied about her chest size. He didn't care about the chest size, he was more mad that she lied. It ended up being a win for the actress, since now she didn't have to do her topless scene. When Miller looks at Van Buren, Most people think he's noticing that she's attractive. In reality, he doesn't care about that. You see, he's not paying any attention to her until he sees the money in her G-string. That's what had him interested. When Van Buren comes out of the strip club, they originally had it so all the guys were staring at her cleavage. They had to redo this, and the costume designer built a dress to accentuate her butt cleavage. One of the director's favorite movies was The French Connection, so he had that in mind while storyboarding the car chases. In the script, Brenda crashes the car into a shoe warehouse. Shoulder changed it to a mannequin warehouse to better fit the theme of the movie. Plus, it made the sequence much creepier. The art department went to buy mannequins and discovered mannequins are expensive. So since they needed most of them to just blow up, they bought two, made molds, and made a few hundred to fill in the warehouse. For the roof scene, Christian did get to shoot a prop machine gun, which was very cool. After that, Gallagher shoots her repeatedly, reloads, and shoots her again. They put squibs under her clothes to explode as she's being shot. Everything was fine until one of the squibs went off and a piece of her jacket shot into her eye. She wasn't injured, but after that she lost the capability of firing a gun without blinking. When Brenda says the line,
"I'm not coming out yet,"
Christian was the one who came up with the idea of making it sound like the parasite was partially in her throat on its way out of her body. They recorded the line and the director deepened it in post. They then had a stuntman put on a wig and do the incredible jump through the neon sign and down the multiple-story building. When Beck falls off the building, the stuntman offered to do it without being attached. They didn't think it was a good idea, so they hid a wire in his sleeve and tied him to this post. The wire dug into the stuntman's arm as he fell, and he had to get stitches. Since the alien could be anyone at any time, they worked on how to give the audience a tell. So at various points in the movie, they have the alien do this tongue thing, which they were even able to get the dog to do. The dog was Roy the Dog, who came back to New Line a year later for the scene in A Nightmare on Elm Street 4. The director continued to rewrite the script while they were filming. Cope was on set for much of the filming and continually wasn't happy with this. Kyle MacLachlan ad-libbed the "your time" on the day of filming.
"The one that you've been tracking for the past
9 years.
9 years.
Your time."
The prop master designed the alien weapon for the finale. They created it as something that would be held by a creature with three fingers. The prop was made out of plastic and painted silver. Unfortunately, whatever plastic it was made out of prevented it from ever drying properly. So whenever somebody picked it up, they left fingerprints all over it. The scene where the alien's chasing the senator was shot in the Park Plaza Hotel. In the original script, Beck just gets shot, but the director wanted to have something with more emotional weight. He rewrote it so he runs out of ammo and tries to plead with his friend who shoots him again, which he said he was going to do when he was in the lieutenant's body.
"Listen, I already shot you once. I can hardly wait to do it again."
For the end, they changed two major things. It was originally going to end on a cliffhanger where the alien gets away in the senator and announces he wants to be president. The director thought audiences wouldn't like the alien winning, so he came up with Gallagher taking it down. He added in the scene where he interrupts the press conference with the flamethrower. He went back and shot a scene that would appear earlier in the film to introduce the weapon. To give the scene more weight, they shot it at 48 frames per second to make it move very slowly. The other major change was the alien completely leaves the senator's body, grows to an enormous size, which Gallagher then blows up. It gave the audience a much clearer look at the monster. Shoulder didn't like this because it felt like it took too much away from Gallagher's revenge, so they reshot it to where he kills it when it first comes out. By this time, the writer had it and was annoyed by all these changes to his script. He asked to have his name removed from the production and for them to use a pseudonym. He used the name Bob Hunt, which was the name he used on the 1981 film The Boogans. At the time for that one, he didn't use his real name because he was afraid of being labeled as a horror writer. Way back in 2011, when I did a video about The Hidden, I completely misunderstood what the director was saying about the ending. He said Gallagher made the ultimate sacrifice when Beck was dying. I took that to mean that he gave his life force to heal Beck. Looking into it further, what he really meant was that Beck did die, and Gallagher's ultimate sacrifice was that he transferred himself to Beck's body and would live the rest of his days as Beck. This was why the daughter was apprehensive about going to him, which is foreshadowed when she first saw Gallagher. It's the main reason I've always wanted to redo this video. Also, so I could dig a little deeper into the production. Earlier in the film, Gallagher says he's from
Ras Al Haq,
which is the brightest star in the constellation of Ophiuchus. Later in the film, the alien calls him Al Hag, which many people took to mean that was his real name, when really he was referring to his planet. The aliens were both living on Altair, and were occupying the Altairians when the events prior to the first film happened.
You left an angry partner for dead on Altair.
We find out in the sequel the evil alien's name was Rutus. Unfortunately, the sequel isn't anywhere near as good as the first. The bouncer at the Ferrari dealership was Dwayne Davis, who played Jerome in the sleeper hit Summer School. The stripper talking to the cops was Shoulder's girlfriend at the time. The guy in the silver Mercedes was Bob Shea, the president of New Line in a cameo. The senator's assistant is Lynn Shea, Bob Shea's sister, who's gone off to become a successful actress in her own right. The cop that Beck takes the gun from on the stairs was Richard Whitaker, the technical advisor, who was also the advisor on Lethal Weapon. The criminal in the jail cell was Danny Trejo, very early in his acting career. They finished filming after 45 days and then returned for 4 days of pickup shots. Claudia Christian was at the premiere and was happy that her fake boobs looked real enough and that her butt looked great on the big screen. The film was released in theaters on October 20th, 1987 and landed in sixth place. It only made about $9.7 million domestically. It did much better on video, but still wasn't the hit that New Line was hoping for. 6 years later, in 1993, the aforementioned sequel, The Hidden 2, was released. It was written and directed by Seth Pinsker, with a minimum involvement from anyone who was in the original. In fact, a good chunk of the film was just a recap of the first. The Hidden's a classic. It's such a unique film in that it relishes in all the same things the evil alien likes. Fast cars, loud music, and so on. It's a shame the writer was so annoyed by the changes in the script, but I do think Shoulder changed things for the better. Cutting out some of the excess that really didn't need to be there did help to keep things moving at a brisk pace. This isn't like some movies where they cut dialogue or character development. They were just shortening things to get to the payoff faster. They still had more than enough character development, with Gallagher getting drunk for possibly the first time while having dinner with Beck's family. Plus, the dynamic goes from Beck being somewhat adversarial to Beck and Gallagher truly becoming a team when it's time to take down the alien. I genuinely love this movie. It has all the excess of the 80s packed into a smart, enjoyable, and fast-moving sci-fi action film.
Anymore.